Welcome to the weekly worship service of First Baptist Church. We're glad that you're joining us today. You know, this is the 11th Saturday. That number was get together on Saturday to record a service for Sunday. This is the 11th Saturday that we have gathered, and Lord willing, this will be the last Saturday that we will need to gather and make a recording to send back to you. This recording has been made possible by the help of a number of folks. First Baptist Church, and I want to acknowledge their ministry and hard work on your behalf once again. I'd like to thank Jim Borman and David Crabb, who each of the 11 weeks have been here running the sound and recording. I'd also like to thank Julie Anderson and Pete Slavinsky, who many of those weeks alternated being here providing us with music. So thank you for being a part of that. Lord willing, next Sunday, June the 7th, we will begin gathering for public worship here at First Baptist Church. I want to talk to you a little bit about that this morning, to make sure that we are all on the same page. I will tell you that lots of prayer, lots of collaboration, lots of deliberation have gone into making this decision and setting the date and setting up some reopening procedures. A couple of comments. We want you to know that we are praying that the Lord would continue to be gracious and merciful, and that these procedures would be able to go away soon. But we feel like, especially as we begin to reopen, that these are reasonable and necessary to help us function well together. So we will be holding two morning services on Sunday morning, and there will be no children's ministries, especially for the first month. That would include nursery as well. However, we would like to especially invite families still come. We are a church family, and your littles are welcome to be a part of our worship service. So, folks, if you're here and you hear a baby cry or there's a toddler around here that's a little restless, that's okay. We love them. We want them here. And we want you as parents to know that your family is more than welcome. Two services will be held at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And we'll do our best to keep them to an hour or less because we want to have a brief time of cleaning between the services in the morning. We're not requiring you to sign up or asking you to sign up, but we're suggesting this. If you would normally have come to Sunday school or brought your family to Sunday school, we'd like to suggest that you consider the 9 a.m. service. If you were typically just attending the 11 o'clock service, well, nothing changes for your calendar. Just plan to be here at 11 o'clock as well. We would invite you to do some self-screening, and also we realize that there are some who aren't comfortable in joining a group again. That's okay. We understand that. We are going to record one of the services just like we did tonight. We just won't need to do it early, and it will be available the same way that you've been getting weekly services for the past 11 weeks. So if you're not comfortable, please know that we completely understand, and we look forward to seeing you as soon as you are comfortable. But we would encourage all who plan to attend in person, do some self-screening, make sure that you're feeling well, and a good adage would be, when in doubt, don't. So if you're wondering, is my cough too bad, is my fever too high, etc., if you're concerned at all about your health, we would encourage you to stay calm, to stay safe, and to keep those of us who are here safe. We are going to practice social distancing as much as we can when we are here, so we will be only sitting in every other room. Every other pew will be vacant. Family units, of course, are free to sit together, but we would encourage you to maintain proper social distancing within the pews when different family units next to each other. Even though we know that we typically shake hands and that we have a number of partners here at First Baptist Church, we're asking for the time being to refrain from both of those, the less contact, certainly, the better. We also comes to a procedure, it is the question of masks. And we are asking that everyone who is 2 years out wear a mask when you enter the building and when you exit the building. And then again, when we say, we talked about the possibility of having worship services without congregational singing, it just felt like that's an important part of our expression of worship to God, so we would like to sing together. But we're asking that you wear a mask during the time that we sing. We'll be doing that a little differently for a little while. Our singing will be at the end of the service, and we'll only sing a song or two. So again, just to be clear, we're not asking you to wear a mask during the entire service. In fact, once you're in the auditorium and see that you are free to take your mask off, we are asking that everyone who comes, who's 2 years and up, wear a mask as you come into the building, as you leave the building, and then again, when we sing. If you have any questions about this, you feel free to give me a call, shoot me an email. I will tell you, I've been surprised that there have been no questions or calls or concerns thus far. I pray that that means that we've got great attitudes and that we communicated clearly, and that we're all on the same page. But we look forward. We have missed you. I'm still looking at the pictures of where some of you opted to sit, but I am much more looking forward to actually seeing you, Lord willing, beginning next week. And I'll also tell you that we are committed to making adjustments as necessary. Obviously, as things get better and better, we will be able to push the procedures to make them looser and looser. Obviously, the opposite is true. If things get more difficult in our area, we may have to take a look and adjust. Continue to pray with us. Continue to pray for us. And we are looking forward again to being together and seeing what God is going to do in the life of First Baptist Church in the days ahead. A number of announcements to keep us all on the same page. Since we are planning to open a public worship next week, I would like to also remind you, for those who have been a part of the Zoom prayer and Bible study, you will realize that your invitation has expired, and that's a good thing. We are planning to meet for prayer meeting this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock in person. I would ask that you bring a little chip. We may have that meeting outside as we begin gathering together for a time of prayer. So, prayer Bible study, Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. Please bring a lawn chair. It will probably be outside unless the weather doesn't permit. Again, looking forward to resuming in-person services next Sunday, 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And just plan on that being the schedule until we tell you differently. And we're looking forward to that. The Challenge for Life, which is Saturday, June 6th. This is the last week to register for that. You can either do the challenge virtually or in person. You can register as a walker, rider, paddler, or runner. Set up your own fundraising page and share it with friends and family to raise money for the geriatric breathing expenses for Insight Pregnancy Services. If you want more information about the Challenge for Life, go to insightpregnancy.com/thechallengeforlife. And also, again, that's the drive-through bridal shower for Amy Kluver, which is Tuesday, June 9th, 7 o'clock at the Fremont Lake Park Pavilion to celebrate her upcoming marriage. Drop off a gift as you wait to run in the drive-through area. If you are unable to attend, feel free to drop off a gift at Cindy Beam's house or bring it to the church on June the 7th. If you have any questions about that, you can shoot Cindy an email at fbcoffice@fbcfremont.com. Great news, the abatement process is done in the education building. We are excited about that. And bids were received on Thursday. The building committee met together and opened them. It looks like we will be within the budget. That's always an important factor. We praise the Lord for that. And we're looking forward to taking the next steps for the building to serve project. Keep your eyes and ears open. There will be more information as things are happening regarding that. A number of items to pray about. I continue to pray for unity in the body, especially as we begin to regather and reopen. I continue to thank the Lord for what He has done among us and in us and through us during this time. physically. Her recovery will take a while, but we are grateful that her injuries weren't more significant. And that she and her family are thankful for the prayers of church friends. Mary Jane Hatton will be having a heart catheterization procedure on Wednesday, September 4th. And we need to pray for Mary Jane and trust that this procedure will be helpful for her. Scott Henry has had us pray for a co-worker named Scotty. Thankfully, he's moved on to the ICU. And is now in a therapy unit. He is able to walk with some assistance. He still has one side of his body. His right side is still affected. But we want to continue to pray for Scotty and for a recovery for him. He's not able to have his family visit him due to COVID restrictions. But we want to continue to pray for Scotty. Shelley Walker's Uncle Roger went to be with the Lord last Monday. And again, we have talked about a number of folks who have recently been promoted to glory, and sometimes that just rolls off our tongues, rolls out of our mouth. But what a joy for us as believers to know that the Bible promises for those who know and love the Lord Jesus Christ and have accepted Him as their Savior, that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so we rejoice with the Walkers and the hope that they have for Uncle Roger. Certainly know that the family that he leaves behind feels grief and bereaved, but they do not grieve as those who have no hope. Finally, Quincy is recovering from knee concerns, but her asthma has been giving her difficulties, so we just want to pray for Gwen this morning that the Lord would continue to help and sustain her. Would you bow with me in prayer? Father, we thank you this morning for being the God that you are. Thank you that you are trustworthy. Thank you that you are faithful. Thank you that you are our constant companion, guide, and friend. Father, thank you for the character that your word reveals about you, the fact that you are holy, that you are light, and that you is no darkness at all. Even as we look at your word this morning, we'll see that your people are very prone to forgetting your holiness, forgetting to apply that holiness to our own lives. And God, I would ask that you would be preparing our hearts to hear from your word, to hear from your Holy Spirit. Prick us, I pray. Change us. Conform us into the image of your beloved Son. Father, thank you for technology. Thank you for the ability that we've had over these last 11 weeks to gather together via virtually via recording. Father, I thank you for all of those who have met and prayed and deliberated and discussed and read literature and articles to decide how it is that we can best and most safely come back together, Lord, looking forward to being with brothers and sisters again very soon. I would ask that you would continue to protect us. I would ask that we have indeed been following your voice and making these decisions. Father, continue, I would pray, to work in us, give us opportunities to show the world that indeed we are followers of an awesome Savior. Lord, we think of those that we know and we love that are currently struggling with health issues. We think of Julie and the significant chemo that she is undergoing. Lord, I would ask that you would give her the ability to tolerate it well, that you would continue to give her strength. I know that she wants to continue to work, so Lord, help her to be able to do that. But we also ask that this chemo would have its intended effect, and that she could be restored to a measure of health and strength. And that very soon. Father, even today is the memorial service for Mila Hart, the little girl that we have prayed for so long. Thank you that you had numbered her days before there was one of them. Thank you, Lord, that you knew every step of her life. You knew about the day that she would have an accident. You knew about the time that she would struggle here on earth. Father, we thank you that our struggle is over, and we thank you that we believe that you are a gracious God. We know that your word tells us that you always so, Father, we pray in confidence, believing that my life is even now in your presence. Would you be especially with her parents today as the finality of her home call hits Nick and Brittany, Phil and Teresa, and other loved ones? Father, we also ask that the glorious name, the glorious power, the glorious life of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, would be proclaimed, and perhaps there would be caregivers or neighbors or friends or even strangers who are watching by live stream that would wonder, how does this couple continue to trust you? And they begin to seek, and as they seek, as she begins a slow and long recovery process, Lord, that you would be her portion, that she would continue to heal physically, but she would also grow spiritually, as perhaps there is more time to reflect on who you are and spend time in your word. God, thank you for the privilege of prayer for those who are praying not only for Kristen, but for many who are on the list. Sometimes, Lord, we feel like prayer is the least we can do. It's actually the best we should do. And we thank you for that ability. We pray for Mary Jane. She has a heart procedure on Wednesday. Would you guide the surgeon, the cardiologist's hands as they seek to determine what's happening with her heart? Lord, we're so grateful for Mary Jane. And would ask that you would raise her up to a full measure of health and strength. Lord, at least as long as we think of Scott Harry's co-worker, Scott, the stroke that he's had and the struggles that he's having as he recovers from that. Lord, we would pray that he could expect that experience of full recovery. Would you encourage the heart of his family, especially his mom, who was unable to be with him because of COVID restrictions? We're so grateful again, Lord, that your word promises that there's no virus, no pandemic, no wrong, no nothing that will ever separate us from you, from the love of your Son, or from your presence, and we thank you for that. As we open your word this morning, God, would you continue to guide us and direct us? Would you continue to prepare us to be the men and women that you want us to be? This morning's message could print just a little bit. Help us not to shy away from them. But Lord, if we are pricked, help us not to just recognize that we're pricked. Help us to actually do something about it. We truly confess that we love you. We truly confess that we long to be the men and women that you created us to be. To be the men and women that we someday will be. To know that someday we will be like Jesus. Lord, help us a little more each day. Reflect more in the expertise and actions of our blessed Savior. In his worthy name we pray. Amen. Well, because of the extended announcements and discussion, we're not having any singing this morning. Again, I look forward to singing with you next week at the end of the service. But for now, I would invite you to take your Bibles, turn to the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah chapter 5. Nehemiah chapter 5. Last week, as we worked through Nehemiah chapter 4, we watched as Nehemiah is the builder's plot on how to overcome obstacles. You may remember that Sanballat, Tobias, the Arabs, the Ammonites, the Amsterdites, did everything in their power they had in mind during Nehemiah recording for us that the law was joined together to keep its height. They set its heart to pray. They remembered the Lord who is great and awesome. They remembered that the Lord had promised to help them. Because they remembered those things that prayed. I love the fact that Nehemiah and the builders had an eye to watch. There were guards who were put in place. And even as the workmen worked, they did so wearing their weapon. That is here. Nehemiah told the builders, wherever you hear the trumpet, assemble in that place. Wherever there's trouble, we'll sound the blast and everyone will come running. Wouldn't that be phenomenal if things about the First Baptist Church family operated that we had eyes to watch? We were watching not only sin in our own lives, but we were watching for the enemy coming after others. If we had ears to hear that when one of us is in trouble, we could sound the alarm and know that our brothers and sisters were going to come running to the rescue. Chapter 5, which I'm going to read a few verses in just a minute, we're going to see that Nehemiah doesn't mention building at all. And it almost seems that there is a pause in the building process. We also see in Nehemiah chapter 5 that the problem is no longer on the outside, but rather it's coming from the inside. It's internal. And we're going to find some lessons of what we need to do when the problem is us. And that's the title of today's message, When the Problem Is Us. Follow with me as I read from Nehemiah chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. Now there was a great outcry of the people and their wives against the Jewish brothers. For there were those who said, we are sons and our daughters are many. Therefore, let us beg grain that we may eat bread. There were others who said, we are mortgaging our fields, our vineyards, and our houses that we might get grain because of the famine. Also, there were those who said, we have borrowed money for the king's tax on our fields and our vineyards. Now, our flesh is like the flesh of our brothers and children, like their children. Yet, because we are forcing our sons and our daughters to be slaves, and some of our daughters are forced into bondage already. And we are helpless because our fields and vineyards belong to others. Then I was very angry when I heard the outcry and these words. I consulted with myself and contended with the nobles and the rulers and said to them, you are exacting usury, each from his brother. Therefore, I held a great assembly against them. I said to them, we, according to our ability, have redeemed our Jewish brothers who were sold to the nations. Now, would you even sell your brothers that they may be sold to us? And they were silent and could not find a word to say. Again, I said, the thing which you are doing is not good. Should you not walk in the fear of our God because of the reproach of the nations, our enemies? And likewise, I, my brothers, and my servants are lending them money and grain. Please, let us leave off this usury. Please give back to them this very day their fields, their vineyards, their olive groves, and their houses. Also, the 100th part of the money, and of the grain, the new wine, of the oil that you are exacting from them. And they said, we will give back and will require nothing from them. We will do exactly as you say. So I called the priests and took an oath from them that they would do according to this promise. I struck out the front of my garment and said, thus may God take out every man from his house and from his possessions who does not fulfill this promise. Even thus may he be shaken out and emptied. begin to break down this passage by looking, first of all, at the situation, and we see that outlined for us in verses 1 through 7. The situation is this: there is a cry from the people. The situation was so grievous, the situation was so important, that it was impacting the building of the wall. You'll notice I did not mention the word wall in the 13 verses that I just read. It's as if an important work has come to a screeching halt, or it's suddenly been placed on the back burner. There was a famine going on, and there were some very specific concerns. In fact, three times over, Nehemiah distinguishes between those concerns by referencing those who sinned. And the concerns were as follows. There were some of the Jews who were starving. There were those who said, "We have no food. Our sons and daughters are many. Let us get grain and that we may eat a little." So there was one group of people that felt like they just didn't have enough. Food was not available. They weren't able to secure it. A second problem was this: we are deeply in debt. There was a second group of people that was able to buy grain, but in order to do so, they had mortgaged their fields, they had mortgaged their vineyards, they had mortgaged their homes. And not only were they needing to borrow money to purchase grain, they were borrowing money to pay the king's tax. And what happened? Well, you only had so much money to begin with, and so all of the money that was available was used to purchase grain. Then you mortgaged as many possessions as you had to get more money to buy more grain or to pay tax. But what do you do when all of your collateral is gone? Well, some of these Jewish people had resorted to selling their sons and daughters into slavery to these nobles and rulers, selling their children into slavery to fellow Jews, because the situation was so significant. Nehemiah had an interesting response in verse 6. The Bible says this: that I was very angry when I heard their outcry and these words. Now, Nehemiah doesn't go into great detail explaining to us why he was very angry, but I think as human beings we can begin to understand why he would be angry. And actually, before he was angry, he did another important thing. He listened. He listened. And what he heard made him angry. And I believe he was angry at the selfishness of the nobles and the rulers. He was angry at their greed. He was angry at their insensitivity. Can you imagine a father or a mother being in such desperate straits that they would suggest, "I'll tell you what, I will sell you my child if only I can get some grace. I will sell you my child if only I can get some money to pay my taxes." We should be able to expect that the nobles and the rulers would be among those who would have been most compassionate. Instead, they were guilty of exploitation. Verse 7 is interesting. It makes me chuckle. Nehemiah says, "I am consulted with my Savior." I know sometimes people say you shouldn't talk to yourself because that makes people wonder if you're all together upstairs. But I once heard a man say that he enjoyed talking to himself because he liked talking to an intelligent person, and he liked hearing an intelligent person talk. But Nehemiah truly had a
appreciate the fact that Nehemiah brought those who were guilty together for correction. Sometimes it's a whole lot easier, for example, in the context of a local church when something's happening that someone doesn't like, that the leaders don't like. Sometimes we just make a new rule. We set a change for everyone because that makes it simple. But Nehemiah didn't just make a rule that applied to everyone or send us an email for everyone hoping it landed in the right set of ears. Rather, he made those who were actually guilty accountable. He calls a meeting of the nobles and the rulers, the violators, and deals with them. Why was he so angry? What was it that these nobles and rulers were guilty of? That's a great question. I'm glad you asked, because that leads us to understand the sin. The sin. Verse 7, the latter part says, "You are exacting usury, each one from his brother." So one of the sins was the sin of usury. And if you think of that word, if I were to ask you to pause for just a minute and say, I'm going to ask a question that requires an answer. What is the definition of usury? Most likely, one of you would give me a definition similar to this. This is from Webster's 9th New Collegiate Dictionary. Unconscionable or exorbitant rate of amount of interest. So when we think of usury, we usually think of what's when you charge too much interest. Like if you have a loan that's at 30% interest, we would say that's usury, that's just crazy. That's unrealistic. But the archaic or the old or the former definition of usury is simply this: interest. We've added it to say, well, you can't charge too much interest. From the very beginning, the word usury simply stood for interest. And Nehemiah says, you, nobles and rulers, you are exacting usury from each brother's brother. Understand that this is a clear violation of God's law. This is what the Bible says from the book of Exodus, chapter 22, beginning with verse 25. If you lend the money to my people, to the poor among you, you are not to act as a creditor to them. You shall not charge him interest. If you ever take your neighbor's cloak as a pledge, you are to return it to him before the sun sets, for that is his own recovery. It is his cloak for his body. What else shall he sleep in? And it shall come about that when he cries out to me, I will hear him. For I am gracious. Deuteronomy chapter 23, the same principle is repeated. You shall not charge interest to your countrymen, interest on money, food, or anything that may be loaned at interest. You may charge interest to a foreigner, but to your countrymen, you shall not charge interest. So that the Lord your God may bless you in all that you undertake in the way which you are about to do. So according to Old Testament law, according to the way the nation of Israel is to treat each other, God has been clear, unequivocal. He can't wait for it. If you lend money to a brother, a Jewish brother, you may not charge. He didn't say don't charge a lot of interest. He didn't say don't charge an exorbitant amount of interest. He said charge zero interest. Instead of charging interest, instead of enslaving your countrymen, nation of Israel was God's chosen people. They were to be different from everybody else. It was His desire to provide for them and to bless them in a tangible way. And by showing grace to those in need, God was freed from grace to be gracious. After listening and being angry, Nehemiah confronts the nobles and the rulers about their sin. And he offers the following solution. Verse 10. And likewise, I, my brothers, and my servants are lending them money and grain. Please, let us leave off this usury. So basically, what he's saying, number one, is stop charging interest. The verse 10 is a little bit curious, as it does involve Nehemiah. And commentators disagree on exactly what Nehemiah is saying. There are some who are saying that Nehemiah simply says that he's lending money and grain, but he's not charging interest. There are others who say that Nehemiah has fallen into the same trap as everyone else, because he uses the word likewise and the word us. At the end of the day, here's the solution. God said, don't. We're going to stop. Let us leave off this usury. I love the fact that, and quite frankly, I think Nehemiah was probably guilty of this as well. But you know what he does as a leader? He steps up to the plate and he owns his sin. This isn't a case where he's just being critical of everyone else and God has what he needs to fix. He's acknowledging that he too has been a little to sleep. He too has been not careful to do all that God has asked him to do. And he's saying, I'm one of you. Let us stop doing this. I'm guilty too. I'm going to own it. Not only does he suggest that they stop charging interest, verse 11, please give back to them this very day their fields, their vineyards, their olive groves, and their houses. Also, the hundredth part, that would be the interest of the money and of the grain, the new wine, and the oil that you are to extract from them. So return the mortgaged property. Any interest that you're collecting on money, grain, new wine, and oil. Nehemiah might have been a great builder, and Nehemiah might have been a great leader, but he was a lousy businessman. How in the world does that make good financial sense? Well, I don't think he was developing a building on a business plan. I don't think he was looking at best banking practices. I think he was looking at the fact of what Almighty God had said. And considering what Almighty God has already done, and understanding what Almighty God could do, and saying, men, leaders, nobles, rulers, we are doing what is right, and we've got to make it right today. So what's they do? Verse 12, they said, we will give it back, and we will require nothing from them. The nobles, the rulers, Nehemiah repented. They understood that they were in violation of what God had said, so that means that they confessed, they agreed with God. We shouldn't be charging interest. We shouldn't be enslaving fellow Jews. So they repented. They had a change in mind or a change in direction. They agreed to do as Nehemiah suggested. As soon as they said, okay, you're right, we're wrong, we need to change it. Verse 12 says, so I called the priests and took an oath from them that they would do according to this promise. The decision was formalized. The priests got involved. I mean, the people could have just said, okay, yeah, Nehemiah will say whatever you want to hear to get you off our back, and then we'll go and do whatever we want. Not so. people and commit to accountability. Nehemiah stripped out his garment, showing that God would seek out those who didn't fulfill their promise. And the people did exactly what they said they would do. I want to close thinking about the similarities. Is it ever possible that here at First Baptist Church, we are the problem? I'm sure that by this time in the history of the nation of Israel, the idea of not charging interest had kind of fallen away. And it wasn't that bad. And it wasn't like they were charging an exorbitant hundredth part that Nehemiah talks about would have been a pretty reasonably low amount of interest for that time. But God didn't say it's okay to charge interest as long as it's not very much. Now understand, this is in the context of the nation of Israel. It has nothing to do with whether a believer would lend money to a believer today. It's dealing with the nation of Israel. But God was clear. So much, and I've got to protect my investment, etc. We can justify lots of things. And I wonder, as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, have we become desensitized to sin, or are there some areas in our lives that maybe like charging a little bit of interest or having just a couple of slaves kind of makes sense for the times in which we live, or is required to control the bottom line? If we really examined our hearts and our minds, would we find more selfishness than God's word allows us to have? If we were to examine our hearts and our minds, would we find a level of self-righteousness that should never exist in a blood-bought believer? The name George Floyd earlier. And I wonder when I mentioned that name, what thoughts went through your mind? Because I do wonder if in my heart or if in your hearts there is a seed of racism or a sense of superiority. Patriotism. I confess to you before that I love America. I love this country. I fear that sometimes we as followers of Jesus love the USA more than we love the Lord Jesus Christ. And if that is true, you've got to know, I've got to know that that is sin. It's pride or covetousness, idolatry, gossip, lust, judgment. Maybe it's fear, maybe it's worry, I don't know what it is. But is it possible that we are the problem? Is it possible that we are choosing not to do what we know God wants us to do? If we think that life, as we know in the First Baptist Church, will just keep going and going and going like the Energizer Bunny, it's not going to happen. Chapter 4, we saw people who had a mind to work, and the wall was completed to Nazareth's height. And in chapter 5, nothing's happening. Why? Because there's sin. Clear sin. The nobles and the rulers were willing to be confronted. Nehemiah stepped up to the plate and said, I'm going to call this thing for trouble. This is sin. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 6, we read, faithful are the wounds of a friend. Do we love each other at First Baptist Church enough that if someone came to us and said, listen, I want you to know I love you, but I see this in your life, you be willing to love someone enough when there's clear evidence of sin to say, listen, you can't do that. It violates the standard that God has set for us. Are we willing? Maybe it's from the laundry list that I read, or maybe it's from something else, but maybe in your heart of hearts, you know deep down that attitudes or actions that you're engaged in just simply are not what God wants. And we have to throw away the excuses. No more, well, that's just my personality. That's just the way I am. That's just who I am. That's not just. Because who we are and what we are to be is to be like Jesus. So is there something that you would say, you know, I know that this area of my life does not measure up to the standard that God has given me in His beloved Son. Would you be willing this very day to confess? To say, God, I agree with you. I'm missing the mark. I'm not what I need to be in this particular area. Are you willing to repent the idea of turning away from it? And Nehemiah got the priests and said, would you be willing to have an accountability partner, to have a friend that you could say, listen, as I was looking at Nehemiah chapter 5, I was convicted of this area in my life, and I want you to know that I confessed it to God. I know it's sin. I'm asking for His help, and I'm asking you, hold me accountable. Keep your eye on me, because I want to be faithful. Challenge and our call is to be holy as He is holy. May God give us the resolve to live lives that reflect His holiness. Father, thank you today for your word. Thank you today for the power of it. Thank you for Nehemiah, who not only was willing to root out areas of sin amongst the builders of the wall, he was willing to acknowledge sin in his own life. How refreshing are the words of Scripture that says we confess our sin. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, Father, I thank you that at the moment of salvation, the blood of your Son, Jesus, paid the penalty for all of our sin, past, present, and future. But Lord, I also know that as we live our lives, there is the fellowship dynamic, there is the relational dynamic, there is mourning, when there is sin in our lives. I would ask that your Holy Spirit would be pricking our hearts, and we would swallow our pride, and that we would long to, it doesn't matter what we think, it doesn't matter what we feel, what really matters.